to introduce our panel. To my right is Anna Joy.
It was live in real time, so you couldn't like put your phone down. But so anyway, I mean, the long and the short is, it was a great place, and you didn't, you know, you could go to a show and you wouldn't have PTSD afterwards from someone being carried out on a stretcher. I mean, that's literally how shows were sometimes. And then on the other hand, there was at times a few too many rules, and some of the eagerness to make the place safe could at times become stifling. It felt a little bit too controlled.
So I have one more question
for you. More good than bad, for sure.
So for many of us in the East Bay punk scene and for many around the world, Operation Ivy is a message of unity, anti-hate, self-examination are something that we hold dear. As kind of a lyrical herald of these early ideas at Gilman, do Do you have any thoughts about how we might all better navigate the world today with the uptick in horrible shit that is currently escalating? Is the idea of unity still, is it passé at this point?
I always feel a little bit uncomfortable trying to be a herald for big ideas, because a lot of my life is just, I'm fucking crazy. But, that being said, so the basic idea in the lyrics, in Op Ivy was, first of all, things are really fucked up, and you have to look at that honestly, or these lyrics are choosing to look at that honestly and say what these problems are. And second of all, that there's something inherent about life that's good, in spite of the fucked upness. So things are bad, and we are going to try and demonstrate something good anyway. And it's almost like the worse things are, the more one is propelled to try and demonstrate in the moment, something good. So, yeah, I mean, it's almost like a lot of issues that Op Ivy addressed that really started with Reagan have kind of spiraled and gotten worse. But I think that hope and the possibility of a better world is still there, even if I can't control how much effect it has in the world at large. I can still believe in it, be conscious of it in myself and others, and try and demonstrate it in my life.
Thank you. In fact, thank you all for answering these lofty questions. I'm not typically a moderator. So,
let's see. Evan.
There you are. Where are we? So, in the film, you discuss your early memories of Quickway and the kind of defiance against not just the sonic rules of punk. Your bandmate in the film, Jules, says, "I didn't get the memo. Like, we didn't want to dress that way, we didn't want to sound that way." I'm wondering, as a composer in the entertainment business and just a comedian, do you still carry any of those same ideas with you now? Is there anything that you learned? I mean, you jump genres, you put out your own records. Those things you learned early on, are they still with you today?
Yeah, I'd say, and I had to learn the hard way about judgment also. Anytime there's a scene that's that deep, like the punk scene was, it defines itself. And, part of what was great about Gimlin was that it was so open, but before that, it was like, metal sucks, right? So I could have seen Metallica for $4, like every weekend. I was like, metal sucks. And it's like, I hadn't even heard a record. And Jules was the one who went, oh yeah, look at this. Look, he's got a GBH shirt on. And I'm like, oh God, I'm so stupid. And now they're the cowbells. So I learned the hard way. It's like, don't judge. And so that definitely sticks with me. I mean, the thing is, what's weird for me, it's like I was being that judgmental, even though I was incredibly eclectic at the time. I was listening to soundtrack music and The Residents and all kinds of weird stuff. So I don't know what, it's just, I don't know what's wrong with human beings where you can be that eclectic and still go metal sucks without listening to it. That's just, my bad for sure. But that just taught me something about myself and people. I didn't think that I was being judgmental. I thought that was just the way it was. And then you hear it go, oh man, those guys are great. So.
I mean, before you even found Gilman, you were putting out your own records. So suddenly there was this place. Can you talk about that? I mean, you were already doing your own thing, and then this place arrived.
Well, to me, it's like that thing where it's, everyone was sort of doing this, we were sort of fighting with it. We're like, no one's gonna put out our record, so we're gonna have to do it ourselves. We pull our resources, and I think everyone was going to the same, probably three Oakland recording studios with the same producers and stuff, for like $15 an hour, and you go record your stuff. And it felt great to have it on vinyl, and felt like it was a real thing, even if no one was buying it.
I had that record.
One, yeah. But actually, it was still a great experience, and you went through the process of doing it, and in doing that, you feel like, well, you can do stuff. And so when I came to LA, I ended up, my first studio was a little garage. I built it. I put the walls in myself. I set up all the gear. I didn't know what I was doing with the gear. I'd ask a bunch of questions to people. How do you get SMPTE timecode to you know, lock up to a VHS machine and have a chase and all this tech stuff. I'm like, I don't know. You just do it and you find out how to do it. And I think that was part of the spirit of the whole thing. I think kind of going back to the question that guy had before about starting it in your own town, it's sort of like you can't sort of turn it into a formula. It's like you had a bunch of bands that were playing, and before Gilman Street, we were doing shows at the parks. We played at the Band Shell in Oakland at Fairyland. That was like, I go back there with my kids and go, I can't imagine hearing some really loud point band playing when you're taking your kid to Fairyland, but we did it. And great show in Berkeley with Hare Krishnas and Quickway and like four other bands. I can't remember who else played. So there's a lot of interesting stuff. You'll find a way. You'll find a place to do it, the garages and all that stuff that people were doing. So I think that aspect of it was really important, just doing it.
The mouse shell sometimes. So thank you.
Gilman is unique, and while it doesn't happen everywhere, it certainly happened in places like LA and Chicago and great venues.
But Jesse, don't you think that because it was happening in the Bay Area with the Berkeley scene and LA is very, like there was Vaginal Cream Davis, it was very Latino, Latinx here, and a kind of an LA Hollywood queer, but there was like all of the, I mean, people's parents had been in the civil rights movements, people's parents were professors. Like it had a really different, very Bay Area, and in particular even East Bay, because of the UC and because of that, the politics there and the political lineage that had happened up until that moment had a very, like a slightly different quality, don't you think?
Yeah, it was definitely different. I mean, every place is definitely different. But, you know, like Jabberjaw and the Smell were also very exciting. So,
sure.
Yeah, not absolutely parallel, but I guess I just wanted to point out that, you know, this scene has this wonderful platform and kind of celebration. But in theory, you could do the same thing here, looking back at, you know, the 90s in LA.
242 Main in Vermont, Lost Cross and Carpendale. I mean, we've seen it everywhere.
Yeah. Underground Railroad was a venue in Morgantown, West Virginia that happened, you know, 20 years before Gilman that was actually very similar.
So, any other questions from the audience? Up there. I mean, we have three screens in one night on fucking Monday in Hollywood. You know, I'm stunned. I thought when we went to New York, we opened it. Thank you. We opened the IFC Center for a week in New York, and they picked it up for another 2 weeks.
Wow.
And when we were there, I couldn't get it out of my brain. Kamala said something in this film. When the skinheads leave, she said they went fuck all that to Concord or wherever the hell they came from. And I thought, well, I know what that means, because where I'm from, that means sports bars and business parks and Pecker Woods and racist assholes, right? And then I realized I was worried, like when we went to New York, is it going to land there, you know? And everyone laughed. Why? Because everybody's a fucking Concord, right? So we had three very, very friendly guidelines at the beginning that our executive producers laid forward. Try not to mystify the past. Try not to try to inspire people. Like, don't make people feel like you missed some sort of legendary train, right? Try to bring in as many diverse voices as possible, because those people, when LGBTQIA folks, people of color, they were doing things there at that point too. And the last one was don't get lost in the acrimony of the backbiting, right? So I think with those kind of original tenets, for however exhaustive this thing is, I find that people are saying they're inspired by it, and they're people are laughing when they watch it, you know? So I am shocked that it's landing as well as it is everywhere. But I'm more happy than I am shocked, so. You.
I have a question for Jesse
Michael. Hey, and it seems obvious, like everyone's, I mean, I don't know about you, but I'm always like, why is the third album always shitty? You know what I mean? Why can't they do it? But the truth is, it's easy to forget. So I guess one thing that I've learned is that I might not want to draw the same nuclear explosion coming out of Reagan's head from when I was 12. But the same basic energy and kind of raw power and sort of creative, I don't know what the word is, vigor is still available to me, even though I'm, you know, not 16 years old anymore.
Any other? Yes, you.
Did everyone hear that question? Did anyone in the back not hear the question but is interested? No, okay. What did I do about being a woman trying to live in patriarchy?
Yeah.
Yeah? I tried to kill myself a couple times. I drank a lot. I used a lot of drugs. I fucked a lot of people. I basically tried to check out in as many ways as possible. And I also was lucky enough to be able to hear and love art, and hear and love passion. And passion comes out in a lot of different ways, and sometimes weird non-binary ways at the same time, right? And so getting back to Corbett's question originally for me and yours, like this, being able to hold multiple oppositions at one time, being able to play and to play fight and to real fight and to not quite know which one you're doing, that is a way to stay alive for me. But when I have to pick, and when somebody makes me have to pick, I either need to kill them, kill myself, leave, or check out, right? And so I need to find some way to live with the fact that there is, you know, that there are all, that there's all these multiple oppositions happening at the same time, and someone's trying to get me to pick really hard with guns behind it and money, and find a way to get support to not do that. Yeah? Okay, and so there are lots of ways to get support. And so I want to say it's like it's not just about the bands. It's, this movie is so great because it's about all the people who are doing things, right? And it wasn't like they were doing things. We are doing things. Yeah? We are doing things.
For now, standing on that, I think it's a good note. Everybody, thank you so much. We're going to head to the other theater. Thank you.